When I was looking for a yoga teacher for myself in the My Yoga Teacher platform where I take yoga lessons from, her profile caught my attention. She is a physiotherapist and a yoga practitioner and a teacher. Here is Stuti Asher. Welcome, Stuti.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Namaste, Deepa.
Let's start with your yoga journey.
So actually, we had yoga as a subject in my physiotherapy course.
Oh.
And, you know, when you are young, when you're really young, what you think, and I also thought the same thing as all, yoga is for boring people, old people, why should we do it? And, you know, so, but it was just introduced, but it's somehow the poses intrigued me, like, you know, always that, you know, we always get attracted by poses, various different poses. And nowadays, especially with social media, everyone is attracted to the asana part of it. And
right.
But, you know, like I said, that it is for boring old people was in still stuck in my head. And my father kept pushing me, you know, he kept on saying that you should do yoga. It is going to be very helpful with your physiotherapy. And again, since you're young, you don't want to listen to your parents. So I kept pushing that idea. I was like, okay, yes, yes, I will do it. I will do it. And I kept pushing it. And then I was supposed to go to the US for my further studies. So I decided to take up that course. I wanted to, you know, bring something more to US as well with me for my health also. So I went to the Yoga Institute, which is 103 years old. It turned 103 today. And
wow.
That's where my perspective about yoga changed completely. I did my yoga course just as an add-on to physiotherapy, but yoga's taken over slowly and gradually. And since then, I've been, you know, trying to incorporate a little bit of it in my life. And I would want to spread it to everyone as well. So I'm very grateful that one thing led to another. So physiotherapy as well as yoga have been an integral part of my life now.
Stuti, you mentioned that you came to the US to do your master's, right? So what was your major like?
So my major was ergonomics, actually, but then gradually it moved to kinesiology. And I also did my thesis in kinesiology. Motor control more so is connected to motor control. So that is what my major was. So I got MS in my kinesiology.
You have studied like anatomy and physiology and also yoga. So what I want to know is, how does knowledge of one field impact or rather influence your approach to the other field?
That's a very nice question, Deepa. Actually, you know, the knowledge of anatomy and physiology has helped understanding what it is doing to your body. So in yoga, it is helpful in understanding the poses and what are these poses doing to your body. So if there's a stretch in this position, how you can better the stretch, how do you align your body to, you know, deepen the stretch or deepen the strengthening of the muscle, how do you do it? So it is very beneficial in that way, especially with alignment.
How about the other way?
Yes, yes, definitely. I would say that, you know, I have become more patient, which is very much required in our profession also, right? Because if you're patient, then you're listening more. Then you're understanding what your patient wants out of you, what the patient is actually, you know, they might be in pain, but is it really connected to just the physical part of it or there is some emotional part as well? So there is some sort of a little bit of a psychological aspect to it also. Like I said, being patient, being more empathetic rather than sympathetic has worked a lot. And it is really helping me in my career as a physiotherapist.
Now that almost everyone is working from home, can you give a few tips to improve the at-home workspaces to avoid that neck, shoulder, let's say repetitive stress injuries?
Yeah. So, what you can do, one thing is avoid sitting in bed at all. Sit in chairs and tables. The table again has to be not very much in higher height than you. So your screen has to be slightly below eye level, not completely such that you're looking up. And your hands should be relaxed if you're using a keyboard and a mouse. Again, repetitive stress can happen with the mouse also. So try to take breaks in between. If your keyboard is there, see to it that there is some sort of a cushioning under your wrist. Otherwise, there's carpal tunnel syndrome also happening. Your elbows are relaxed and they are on the armchair. So arms of the chair, they are placed properly. Otherwise, it can also cause to, elbow, shoulder pain as well. So you have to align your workstation in such a manner such that it is completely supported and your back is supported for your inner chair as well. So you're not like constantly always sitting at the edge of your seat and not completely relaxed also, not like you're letting go of all your weight onto the armchair and so that there's no strain on your spine as well. One thing which is very important is that your feet should be touching the floor. Okay, if your height of the chair is not adjusted, if it is adjustable, adjust it. If not, then take a small stool and place your feet on the stool. Your feet hanging also is not advisable. Another very important thing is that always take breaks. Half an hour is recommended, but if it doesn't happen in half an hour, at least 1 hour, get up, walk around the house. So that circulation is happening, and I'm sure they must all know this, but it's just that we don't want to do or we forget to do. So set an alarm. Like, nowadays people also set alarm to drink water. They forget to drink water. So set an alarm, or every time you drink water, get up and walk. Like one of my teachers said, he gave a very nice example. He said, "I never carry a bottle of water with me." And I asked why. So he's like, if I carry the bottle of water with me, if it is there on my workstation, I'll just drink it. I make it a point to go to the kitchen, walk towards the kitchen, drink water, and come back. So that way, his walk also happens. Your walk will also happen. So that is a very good thing that you can do. Maybe not keep water at all with you, or coffee, or tea, or anything, so that you have to go, get up, and get it back. So one is that doing some neck movements is also very beneficial. So just looking up and down, side to side, maybe some side rotations is there, and just moving your shoulders a little bit. That will also take care of, avoiding any form of injuries or pain.
On the same note, housewife, a homemaker, I know that some of my friends, they're overwhelmed and they don't get to do exercise too. They don't get time to exercise.
What I have understood is that if you don't have time for yourself, you're not happy. If you're not happy, you're not able to keep others happy around you. If you take that responsibility of keeping yourself happy and take some time out for yourself, you will be at the peace of mind and you will be able to, radiate that peace, or you will be able to give that peace to your family members also. Just calm yourself down. Relax yourself, do some breathing exercise, or do some shavasana also is very good. It is the most difficult asana, we say, in yoga, because it is
Oh,
very hard
really?
to relax. It is very hard to relax, right? When we talk about shavasana, everyone thinks it's just to go to sleep. No, it is not. You are consciously relaxing your body as well as your mind. So that relaxation, if when you are in Shavasana, most of the times we go to sleep because you are very tired. You don't really realize that you are not supposed to sleep in Shavasana. It is an asana. It is a posture. So when you are lying down, tell me, there are still many people who don't like Shavasana because there is nothing to do, right? In Shavasana, you're not supposed to do anything. You're just supposed to be there, not even think at that point of time. Because now in Shavasana, when you're there, somebody will be thinking, oh, what am I cooking for dinner? What am I going to, I have to pick up my kids from school. Right now, maybe not, but oh, this work is remaining. Oh, there's an itch in my foot. How do I move? The teacher will see. So there are these things happening in your mind because your mind is not at rest. So Shavasana is to bring your mind at rest. So even if they do this much, they will see that their productivity increase. So maybe that, and just sitting and listening to the sounds around them, that is also going to help relax them because your mind is occupied somewhere else, not thinking about other things.
So I was talking to a couple of my friends that I'm going to be talking to you. Okay, one of them have osteoarthritis. So she wants to know whether osteoarthritis can be the initial stage. She has been like diagnosed with the osteoarthritis in her, I think, right knee. And she wants to know whether yoga can prevent any further damage.
Yes, I would say definitely. See, what happens in osteoarthritis is again, it is just normal wear and tear of the body. So your bone is, there is wear and tear of the bone because of course you're walking, if you said right knee, am I correct?
Right knee.
Yeah. So it is constantly in use whenever you're walking, sitting, standing, you're doing, putting pressure on it. So there is going to be normal wear and tear. Now, how will you help it? You will have to help by taking the load off the knees. And how do you take the load off the knees is by doing some strengthening asanas. Okay, so you'll have to do some strengthening of the muscles. Okay, that will help take the load because the muscles also become weak, right? So that is why this joint, which is there, sort of they must have said that the gap has reduced, right? So it
Correct.
sort of comes down a little bit. So the muscles need to work as holding the bones in place. So if you work on the muscles, if you work on strengthening these muscles, then it'll help in, keeping the bones in place in proper alignment, and it will avoid friction more so. Again, weight management is also important if the person is overweight, so that there's not a lot of pressure onto the knee joint. So she can start with some gentle exercises, which we call as Sukshma Vyayam, which is warm up, which is very much beneficial for your joint flexibility and mobility of your joint and flexibility of your ligaments around the joint. So she can start with that and then progress on to slightly intense asanas and further on.
Let's take plantar fasciitis. Can you recommend some specific stretches?
So in plantar fasciitis, what happens is that there's tightness of one of the fascia in the foot, in your foot. Okay, so whenever they put their foot down first thing in the morning, it gives a lot of pain, right? So what they can do in the bed is that they can do this toe curl, opening, flexing and opening the toes. Then the ankle movement is there a little bit, circular rotation of their ankles is there. Then they can also do some stretching of their foot. So again, holding their toes and holding one hand is holding the heel and one hand is holding the toes, and they are just stretching the foot a little
Oh.
bit. Just put here and you can just stretch. And relax. Stretch. You're pulling both your hands away from each other and relaxing. They can also just take their hand and place it in the toes and just help with the rotation movement so that it is rotating, the ankle is rotating completely. So this way. And then you have your toe curling and again, try not to put the toes on top of each other as much as you can. Spread your fingers as much as you can.
How much yoga per day is good, or how much yoga per day is bad?
Ideally, 1 to 1.5 hour of yogasana is more than sufficient in the day. Nothing in excess is good. Yeah, anything in excess is always going to harm you. Now, if you keep on doing one thing repeatedly again and again and again and again, right, in the day for hours together, it is going to cause some sort of a strain. So it can also lead to injuries if not done correctly. So I would suggest 1 to 1.5 hour is more than enough. But if you're doing, let's just say, 1 hour of asana practice, Then if you go to another group class which is focusing more on breath work, so your pranayams and meditation, then do that.